Praise the Lord, everybody. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise this morning. Amen. He's worthy. We serve a mighty God. We're going to pray right now, and then we're going to go into the word of the Lord. Father God, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment. We thank you for every opportunity that you're giving to us right now. Father God, we just ask that you just give us nice weather for the next few moments. And Father God, you just do what you want to do in this service. We turn it all over to you. For everybody that's out here and everybody that's listening and everybody that's going to hear this word, Lord, let it be personal to them. Let it make sense to them. Let it challenge them and let it undergird and strengthen them. Your word is always true, Father God. So we bind anything and everything that's against you. We bind every single distraction, everything that's not of you. We bind it. We uproot it. We cast it out. And Father God, we release your power and your presence and the holy angels to be here to minister to us, the heirs of salvation. Use me as you will, as your oracle, as I speak what thus saith the Lord. And I claim that the word won't fall on deaf ears or hardened hearts, but the word will go forward and do what you intended to do. We are blessed. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to go into the Bible now. It's going to be Ecclesiastes 11, verses 1 through 6. Ecclesiastes 11, verses 1 through 6. Once you get it, give me one hunk. That's right. Amen. Ecclesiastes 11, 1 through 6. Once you get it, give me two hunks. Are you guys getting better at this? Okay. Ecclesiastes 11, 1 through 6. Give me three honks when you get it. Amen. Amen. I'm going to read several different versions, so be patient with me. The first verse says, send your bread out on the water because in the course of time you may find it again. Give a portion to seven people, even to eight. You don't know what disaster may come upon the land. If clouds fill up, they will empty out rain on the earth. If a tree falls, whether to the south or to the north, wherever it falls, there it will lie. Those who watch the wind blow will never sow, and those who observe the clouds will never reap. Just as you don't understand what the life breath does in the fetus inside a pregnant woman's womb, so you can't understand the work of God who makes everything happen. Verse 6 says this, scatter your seed in the morning and in the evening, don't be idle. Because you don't know which will succeed, this one or that, or whether they both will be equally good. Another version says, invest your money in foreign trade, and one of these days you will make a profit. Put your investments in several places, many places, even because you never know what kind of bad luck you're going to have in this world. No matter what direction a tree falls, it will lie where it fell. When the clouds are full, it rains. If you wait until the wind and weather are just right, you will never plant anything and never harvest anything. God made everything, and you can no more understand what he does than you understand how new life begins in the womb of a pregnant woman. Do your planting in the morning and in the evening too. You never know whether it will all go well or whether one planting will do better than the others. Another version says, ship your grain across the sea. After many days, you may receive a return. Invest in seven ventures, yes, in eight. You do not know what disaster may come upon the land. If the clouds are full of water, they pour rain on the earth. Whether a tree falls to the south or to the north, in the place where it falls, that's where it will lie. Whoever watches the wind will not plant, and whoever looks at the clouds will not reap. As you do not know the path of the wind or how the body is formed in a mother's womb, you cannot understand the work of God, the maker of all things. Sow your seed in the morning and at evening, let your hands not be idle, for you do not know which will succeed, whether this or that. or they will both do equally well. Amen? Father God, right now as I bring your word, Lord, let it be anointed. Let the appointment be set and let the appointment be met. Whatever I say and whatever I do, let it bring you glory and honor. And let your children receive. In Jesus' name, amen. I've entitled this sermon this morning, What Are You Waiting For? What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? If I had more time, I would fill in the blank. If things would just slow down, then I would, you fill in the blank. If there was a still, calm season in my life, then I would, you fill in the blank. If I weren't so busy, then I would, you fill in the blank. If I could just find quiet time, then I would, you fill in the blank. Can I ask you something? Don't you right now have more time? Haven't things slowed down? Isn't this a still and calm season? Aren't you less busy? And in so many ways, aren't times more quiet? Okay, maybe you're waiting for normal to return. It's not going to. Okay, maybe you're waiting to understand everything. You won't. Or maybe you're expecting things to line up just perfect. They won't. What I believe is while everyone else is fearful, while everyone else is confused, and while everyone else is worried, this is your best and really ordained time to gain. However, if you don't sow, you can't reap. If you don't invest, you can't get a return. If you don't try, you don't have a chance. If you don't give, you can't receive. If you're afraid, you can't do anything. If you're waiting for perfection, you won't move. If you can't dream, you can't get to your future. If you're apprehensive, you will miss your opportunity. If you don't plant, you can't harvest. If you're complacent, worried, or scared, you can't hear me at all. So I ask you right now, what are you waiting for? If we go back into the word and dissect it a little bit, Solomon, who wrote this book of the Bible, Ecclesiastes, is considered the wisest man who ever lived. Solomon had wisdom that conquered kingdoms. He had people just come to hear him, listen to him speak on any and every topic. God blessed him with so much wisdom. So he wrote this book, and he told us to cast our bread, to give of our resources, to give of our talents, to give of our treasures. And he says, be diligent and active when we do this. It says when we invest, he gives us the promise that you will find it. It will return unto you. There will be a return on your investment. And it said after a while, after many days, after a season. He says, but as soon as you give, you put in operation God's principle. Giving gives you the right to activate God's principle. Then he says, give unto seven or even unto eight. He says, give broadly, give generously, give to many. Give into many ventures, give into many different ideas. Invest is called diversification of your investments. And then you create multiple streams of income. Okay? For you don't know what misfortune may come upon the earth. We're giving and knowing that bad things happen sometimes. However, in this season, I will tell you, those of you that have been givers, those of you who have been given to the kingdom work, those of you who have been given whatever you can, you need to sit back and wait for your investment to come back to you because it's a promise because you've already invested. Amen? Yeah. And then it says this, throw caution away. It said the clouds, when they're full, that's when they rain. They don't wait. You know we live in a desert, right? We got a little bit of rain, more different than we normally have. But it's still the desert. It's 100 some degrees today. So it's still the desert. As much as the desert needs the rain, you know that the ocean receives the most rain. The reason why the ocean receives the most rain is because the ocean gives the most moisture back to the clouds. And also, the ocean is bigger than any other thing, landmass on the earth. Because the ocean is that biggest entity, it gets the most of the rain. But even though the clouds are, even though we could know that it's parched out here, it's dry out here, and we need some rain, as soon as the clouds are full of rain, that's when it rains. And it says a tree, if it falls to the north or to the south, that's where it lays. So it says this, if you're going to watch the wind, you won't plant. If you're going to be scared in this moment, you won't plant. If you're going to be afraid of everything that's bombarding people right now, you won't invest. If you're going to watch the conditions like we talked about last week and get your eyes off Jesus, you will not do the work you've been called to do. You will not step out. You will not launch out. You will not have faith to move out. All you will do is curl back up and pull back, and you will not be able to see the hand of God moving as it's moving right now, because you will be too stuck on looking at something that's temporary instead of the one that promised you the eternal blessings. We won't sow if we're looking at the wind. And then it says we will not harvest if we're observing the other things. So if you don't sow, if I don't sow, we can't expect a harvest. Amen? Then it says this. If we're waiting on perfect conditions, we'll never do it. If you and I right now are waiting for things to be perfect somehow, some way, before we decide to do the work, before we decide to get a different mindset, before we decide that this, whatever is going on, is not going to limit me, it's not going to hinder me, but I got to wait for it to get perfect. I got to wait for everything to line up just right. I got to wait to get 10 confirmations. I got to wait to see an angel come to my door and ring my doorbell. I got to see 17 pigeons walking in marching in line, and then God has spoken to me. I'm telling you right now, God is speaking to you now. The conditions may not appear to be perfect. However, it's the perfect time to sow, and it's the perfect time to expect the hand of God to move. See, God moves when everybody else is afraid. God moves when everybody else is confused. God moves when everybody else has a lack of understanding. God moves when people cannot seem to get it together. God moves when we don't have the answers. God gets to step in times where we lose control because we were never in control in the first place. But if we wait for things to become perfect, we won't be able to activate the hand of God moving, because we play the part in giving. We play the part in doing, and then God returns. And verse 5 says this, just as we don't know the path of the wind or how the bones are formed in a pregnant woman, so we don't know the way that God does things, the one who makes everything. We don't have to understand how he's going to do it. We don't have to get a blueprint of how he's going to do it. He doesn't have to tell us every step that he's going to do to make it happen. All we have to do is activate our faith and trust him at his word and remind him of what his word said and tell him I'm sitting back expecting the harvest because I sowed when you told me to. I sowed when it was windy. I sowed when the conditions weren't right. I sowed when everybody else was running away. I sowed when it didn't make sense. I sowed when I didn't have much to give. I sowed what I didn't understand. But I sowed, and now I'm expecting you who does everything to make it come to pass. So it says, sow your seed early. Sow your seed early. And don't be idle with your hands in the evening. For you don't know if one thing's going to be good or they're all going to be good. But this is what the word says. Something is going to be good. Amen? So, I'm kind of reminded of a story about a widow woman and Elijah. Y'all know something about that story? It's in 1 Kings 17, 7 through 16. This is when there was a famine, a drought in the land. A drought that was lasting, ended up lasting for 3.5 years. And Elijah, who was a prophet of God, had been sent by God to a brook. And at the brook, he commanded ravens to feed him there. So God had birds come and feed Elijah over and over and over again. Amen? And then it said the brook dried up. The brook dried up. And you know what he said? Go to this city of Zarephath, the widow of Zarephath. And I've told a woman, a widow, to sustain you there. And Elijah, who knew the voice of God, I want you to hold on to it. Elijah knew the voice of God because the same God who told him that ravens would feed him is the one who told him where to go and the one who told him what was going to happen. That's what God's word does. He comes to you in his word, and he tells you what to do, and he tells you what's going to happen if you listen. If you listen, and then if you obey, you'll get the promises of what God promised you. Some of us aren't listening, and since we're not listening, we're not obeying. And since we're not obeying, we're not getting the promises. And some of us are frustrated in the places that we are because not because God hasn't spoken, it's because we haven't listened. And since we didn't listen, we didn't open up. And since we didn't open up, we didn't obey. And since we didn't obey, we're still stuck in our same conditions. Well, this is what I came to tell you. There's a voice that's coming right now. And I bind everything that's been hindering your hearing. I bind everything that's been messing you up from hearing from God. And I bind every single thing that's been working contrary to the word of God in your life. He told Elijah to go there. And that widow woman will sustain you there. And the story goes that Elijah comes up to the woman. And he asked her, give me, if you will, a cup of water. And then while she's going to get the cup of water, he says, and by the way, can you bring me some food? I'm hungry. And she stopped right there and said, as surely as your God lives. Somebody got to hear this, that we serve a living God. We serve a powerful God. We serve an almighty God. We serve a God who is over a famine, who's over a sickness, who's over a disease, who's over a season that's negative. We serve a God who is almighty, who's not penetrated by any type of thing. He's almighty. She said, as surely as your God lives, all I have is enough for me and my son to eat one last meal. And then we're going to die. You know what happens in those times? It's almost like the woman said, how insensitive. How can you be so insensitive? You know it's a drought. You know it's a famine. You know there's no food anywhere. You know that the stores are shutting down. You know that the distribution channels are getting messed up. I don't have anything. How can I can get you some water because I got a little bit of that extra. But how can you be so insensitive to ask me to stretch? How can you be so blind to ask me to stretch? How can you be so numb to ask me to stretch? How could you not be okay with me just balling up and being fearful? How come you just can't be okay and understand that I have a right to just be curled up? How can you be so insistent? How can you challenge me at a moment like this when everything is just against me? How dare you? Preacher, how dare you stand up on a rooftop and tell me that everything is going to be all right? How dare you tell me that God is working somehow, some way? How dare you challenge me and say, even though it's your last, you give your last and watch what God will do? Because he asked her to give his last, to give her last. She wasn't operating out of a surplus. She wasn't operating out of the fat. She was operating out of the last. He asked her for everything that she had. Sometimes you might be down to nothing. And you might have an agenda, you might have a conversation like that widow woman. She said, as surely as God lives, your God lives, I got just a little bit of food and I'm gonna make it for me and my son. And then after that, when it runs out, when we can hold, no longer hold, and our body can no longer hold up, we're gonna shut down and we're gonna die. That's her plan. That was her plan. See, that's what happens when you can only see in the natural. You have a natural plan. But see, this is what I came to tell you, that God does not operate in natural plans. God is a supernatural God operating in supernatural ways, trying to get you to a supernatural place. So do not limit God's super by holding on to your natural. Let God's super couple with your natural so supernatural things can begin to happen even in time of famine. That's insensitive, Pastor. Why would you challenge me when I don't have much strength? Why would you challenge me when I don't have many options? Why would you challenge me when I don't have many resources? Because that's the best time. When you don't have options, when you don't have resources, when you don't have a plan, that's the best time for the challenge. So what she did then, her confession was, me and my son are going to eat this last meal, and then we're going to die. But her condition and her confession were changed by her obedience and her investment. She obeyed. And she gave to the prophet of God. She obeyed and she invested in the prophet of God. And as soon as, not before. Wait a minute. Let me find it. 1 Kings 17. Let me find it. Y'all got a second, right? All right. Uh-huh. So when he went and did according unto the word of the Lord, okay, 17:7, here we go. Yep, she was going to fetch. And Elijah told her in verse 13, fear not. Why do we keep dealing with fear? Why do we keep dealing with fear? If she was already planning her death, why would she be afraid at the last moment, already knowing what the end was going to be? He told her, in order to unlock your blessings, in order to unlock God's supernatural, in order to be able to do something different when other people are doing something the same, in order to step out, in order to elevate up, in order to go to the next dimension, fear not. See, the thing that causes some of us to not be able to go to the next dimension, to go to the next level, to even receive a right now injection of a word, is that we're afraid. We're afraid. And the thing is, it's already been lined out. She had a confession that I'm about to die. And the one that I love, my only child, is about to die too. So what did she have to lose? She had nothing to lose but everything to gain. But at the same time, when fear was trying to grip her, the prophet told her, just like I'm telling the church, just like I'm telling everybody, fear not. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid to endure the season. Do not be afraid that you don't have the answers. Do not be afraid that you cannot figure it out. Don't be afraid. I came to tell you, don't fear. Because if you don't fear, you can unlock God's potential. If you don't fear, you can unlock God's blessings for you. If you don't fear, you can go to the next dimension while other people are stuck in the twilight zone. But you have to fear not. You have to give no place for fear. You got to kick fear out of your mind. You got to kick fear out of your bed. You got to kick fear out of your dreams. You got to kick fear out of your house. You got to kick fear out of your job. You got to kick fear out of your relationship. You got to kick fear out of your mouth. Fear not. Fear not. Then he said, go and do as you said, but take care of me first. Give me some first. And then he said, for thus saith the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall your cruse of oil fail, until that day that the Lord send rain upon the earth. And then she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither did the cruse of oil empty or fail, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. Didn't run out. That was 3 years and 6 months. And Jesus alludes to this woman in the New Testament. He said there was a lot of widows in the land at that time. But God was only sent Elijah to one house. And since she was obedient, she ate for 3 years and 6 months. God has sent a word to your house. God is sending a right now, right this moment word to your house. And I'm speaking as his oracle to say, don't be afraid. You said something, but change your confession. You believe something, change what you believe. If you are obedient at this moment and you change what you're saying, God will change what he's doing. Do you know that you can make your world with what comes out of your mouth? So if you're not afraid and you say, I'm the righteousness of God, if you say, I'm above and not beneath, I'm the head and not the tail, I'm the lender and not the borrower, I am in God. If we would confess something different by hearing the voice of God, I came to tell you, no reason to be afraid. No reason to tuck your tail. No reason to hide. This thing too soon shall pass. By the way, God has it all under control. So what are we doing right now? We still waiting for conditions to get just right. We're still waiting for somebody to tell us it's free to live. My God, if you don't give me breath, you can't tell me what to do. Amen. Did I turn off? Amen. If you don't give me breath, you can't tell me what to do. I trust in God and I trust in the word of God. He's ordering my steps. Amen. He's given me wisdom how to navigate this season. He's given you the wisdom how to navigate this season. We don't have to trust in anybody else other than God. Amen. Because if you have a tuning in to God's frequency, you will understand when God's voice is coming to your ear gate. And you will understand in your mind what God is telling you. And then you will be obedient to what God has told you to do. And you will get the promises of the blessings. Every time God tells you to do something, there's a blessing in the end. Every time that God challenges you to do something, there's a blessing in the end. Every time that God tells you which way to go, there is a future in the end. God has given us life in this difficult time, and abundant life still in this difficult time. So what are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Why are you waiting for anything? Between the years 1929 and 1939, the electric razor was made. The car radio was invented. Monopoly board game came into existence. The chocolate chip cookie was born. Spam, the food, was made. The first digital computer was invented. Macaroni and cheese was invented. And the supermarket itself was invented. What's funny is between those years, 1929 and 1939, that was the Great Depression. That was the worst economic times ever. And you know, some people, instead of just cowering down and just going away, they decided, I'm gonna make something. I'm going to invent something. I'm going to do something. I'm gonna step out somewhere. I'm gonna elevate. I'm gonna rise. I know the conditions are bad. I know that people are begging, but right now, I don't have time to beg. I got some stuff to make. I got some promises to gain. I got some things to make come true. I gotta not waste my energy on doubt and fear, but put my energy into making something happen. You see, what are you waiting for? The things that you're complaining about are supposed to be the things that you create. The things that don't exist, and you said, I wish I had, it's your moment to make those things happen. You know, I don't know how to get to such and such and so and so. Do you know how to get on your knees and ask God, open the door? I don't know how to reach out to this person, but do you know the Alpha and the Omega? He answers your prayers. You might not have the plan, but God will send somebody your way. God will send a word your way, and God will put it in your heart in such a way that it'll weigh on you like a ton of bricks till you will say, that's God talking. And then when you get up after you finish crying, then when you lift your pants up or straighten your skirt up after you finish crying, and when you get your face all together after you finish crying, see, after you finish crying, you'll quit looking at the thing that was making you cry, and you will start listening to the thing that's spurring you forward. You'll stop looking on the negative things, and you'll start looking at the promise and the positive things. You won't waste your time on saying the same thing that everybody else is saying. You won't waste your time on quoting the statistics of a disease like everybody else. See, and what we're focused on is how many people have perished. But you know what we should be focusing on is how many people have recovered. We should be focusing on how many people that have recovered. I'm not saying it's not a bad thing, it's not a sad thing, but there's many more who have recovered than those who have perished. I came to speak a recovery word to you right now. You might have been stuck, not by COVID-19. You've been stuck by the fear. You've been stuck by the confusion. You've been stuck because you didn't know what you were supposed to do. You were stuck because you didn't have the finishing touches on this whole thing. Well, I came to release you and get you, if I can say it, unstuck. This is the word of the Lord. The time is perfect. The season is right now. The opportunity has never been greater. The expectation should not be any higher. This is the time. This is the season. This is the moment. It's the time for your breakout. It's the time for your elevation. It's the time for you to gain. It's the time for your harvest to come. See, your harvest might not come like you said, like you thought it would. Your harvest might come with a right now on time invention. because we're expecting and want normal. I already told you, it's not gonna happen. But there is a new normal. And guess what? God said he's doing a new thing in the desert. He said, can't you see it? I'm doing something new on the rooftop in Indio. I'm doing something new in the parking lot of Indio. I'm doing something new. The thing, he said, don't worry about the former things or the things of old. He said, come on to the new things. Don't wish for the old things. He said, come on to the new things. Don't say I was so comfortable when I had a confession that I'm just gonna eat this and die. He said, come on to the new things. He said, don't stay stuck, but come on to the new things. He said, I had to get your attention. I got your attention. Now I want to make something brand new. Since we agree it cannot be the same, let's make what's going to happen the new thing. It's up to you to make the new thing. You don't have to sit back and say, what's it going to be? You start saying, it's going to be this. It's going to be that. I'm going here. I'm going there. I'm about to open this business. I'm about to create this line of clothing. I'm about to do this. I'm about to do that. You create what's going to be new. Quit living with the dead and old. You start creating the new. You start creating the new. Do I got a witness? Let me hit you with this. Now's the perfect time for you to. Now's the perfect time for you to birth your ideas. Now's the perfect time for you to develop both personally and professionally. Now it's time for you to acquire and take expansion. Now's the time, the perfect time for you to invent something. Now's the perfect time for you to improve on something. Now's the perfect time for you to focus. Now's the perfect time for you to leave some people where they are. Now is the perfect time for acquisition. Now is the perfect time for progress. Now is the perfect time for you to leave every bit of fear behind you. Now is the perfect time for you to invest. Now, y'all hearing me? Now is the time, the perfect time for you to walk in dominion. Now is the perfect time for you to create the new normal that you want. Now is the perfect time for you to delete all the dead files. Now is the time for you to upload the new files. Now is the time for you to defy complacency and conformity. Now is the perfect time for you to walk in boldness. Now is the perfect time for you to speak with authority. Now is the perfect time for you to dream bigger. Now is the perfect time for you to embrace and expect dominance. Now is the perfect time for you to enlarge your territory. Now is the perfect time for you to try something new. Now is the time for you to give, to sow, and go to another dimension. Now is the time for you to take over, the perfect time. Now is the perfect time for you to create things. Now is the time, perfect time for you to implement new things. Now is the time, perfect time for you to build things. Now is the time, the perfect time for you to talk in faith only. Now is a perfect time for you to expect great harvest. The world is ripe for your harvest. What are you waiting for? What have you let talk you out of your dreams? What have you let get you derailed? What have you let take your positive, energetic enthusiasm away? What have you allowed to push you back and become a less than or a second class citizen? What have you just start taking instead of demanding what you want? What have you just started just dealing with and becoming comfortable with and becoming attached with that you know you should disembark from because that's the reason why you're holding back? I would ask you to open your spiritual eyes
And I would ask you to really look at things from a godly perspective. Really look at things from a God who's in complete authority, who's sovereign, who is completely in control. And I would ask you, do you think he's crying? Do you think he's afraid? Do you think he's giving up? Do you think he's hopeless? Do you think he's withdrawn? Do you think that he is afraid? Do you think that he is confused? Do you think the Almighty God does not know every single moment of what is happening, and you and I are sitting here and we're stuck, and God is sending us his word? He's sending us his right now word. He's sending us a bondage breaking word. He's sending us a yoke destroying word. He's sending us a limit killing word. He's sending us a blessing word. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? What I expect as your pastor is that you'll get to business. What I would expect as your pastor is that you write a letter to your fear and say, I'm divorcing you. What I would expect from you as your pastor is to say, if people come into my life that are not speaking faith, I gotta tune them out. What I expect for you is to open up your eyes and recognize that God is in the blessing business and he's trying to get blessings to you, but you cannot watch the wind and you cannot look at things that are not going right. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? Whatever you're waiting for, I want you to check it off. Whatever you told you had to wait for, I want you to check it off. What you've been taught, if it's been generation after generation that you have to wait, I want you to check it off. I want you to get rid of everything that you think you have to wait for. And then I want you to just stand firmly in God's word. Stand firmly in his promise. It said, cast your bread upon the waters, because you'll find it after many days. Give unto seven and even unto eight, because you don't know what evil's going to be upon the land. Then it says, if a tree falls to the north, that's where it falls. And it says, when the clouds are full of rain, that's where the rain comes. It said, the person that observes the wind won't sow. And since you don't sow, you don't have the right to harvest. If you don't plant, you can't reap the harvest. If you don't give, you can't receive. So if you don't do it because you're looking at your conditions, you won't be able to expect the harvest. And it says, just like we don't know how the body is formed, how bones are formed, how God makes creation and life in a woman's womb, we won't understand how the blessings come. We don't have to understand how the blessings come. It's not our job to figure out how the blessings come. It's our job to plant and to receive the blessings. It's our jobs to come in tough times and hard times and difficult times and sow when nobody else will. It's our time. It's our time to invest right now. You know right now more millionaires can be made right now, because so many people are afraid and so many things have to change, that if you just get your God intellect right, by the time this storm is over, you will be not just out there, you'll be up there. You'll be in a whole new place. You'll be in a whole nother level. You'll be living in another dimension, because you did not operate in fear. So check the box off. Check that box off. And quit telling yourself you have a good reason not to do what you should do. You quit making a deal with yourself to keep yourself stuck. It's not the devil. It's not your coworker. It's not even COVID-19. It's you. It's you. It's you. And guess who is going to be the catalyst in changing? It's you. It's you. So listen to this as I close. The world is ripe for your harvest. Number one, just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Oh, but I don't have the plans. Just do it. I don't have it all figured out. Just do it. How many times have you tried to bake a cake and didn't get it right, and then you didn't quit baking cakes? You just refined the recipe, and now you can bake a cake. Just do it. How many times do you have to go to a conversation with somebody and they didn't receive it, but you had to have a conversation, and eventually, instead of you guys fighting, you guys became friends after a while? Just do it. Just do it. Do it now. That's number two. See, because people say, yeah, I'm gonna do it, but I'm gonna do it later. No, not later, later. Right now, right now. Just do it now. By the time you, I don't want you peeling out of the parking lot, but I want you going out of the parking lot real fast, because you wrote so many things down that you, when you get home, you're gonna start doing it right now. Do it now. Do it in this climate. Because if you're gonna observe the wind, if you're gonna look at things at the way they are, you might not sow. But do it in this climate. You know why? Because this is the most fertile climate there has been in your life. This is not the worst time. This is the best time. This is not the most negative time. This is the most positive time. You know, if you're the only farmer who's farming crops right now while everybody else is afraid, you're the only one who's going to have a harvest. So your crops are going to be valuable, they're more valuable than they've ever been. Do it in this climate. Don't wait until everything lines up. I told you to check the box already. Do it with everything that's in you. Go all in. Give it every single thing you have. Every single mental, every single physical, every single emotional. Fix your mind, your heart, your spirit on this and put everything you got into it. And the last one I want to tell you is do it expecting a great return and a harvest. I'm not going to be cute with you now. When you give, according to the word, you can expect to receive. When you give, cast your bread up on the water, because you're going to find it after many days. That's called a return on investment. When the widow woman went and did what Elijah told her, guess what he said? You go be having the best return on investment out of every single widow that's here. They're gonna die, but you're gonna live. She expected what the man of God said to come true, and she was expecting a return of her investment. So when you do it expecting a great return and a great harvest. See, in every single orange, there's a number of seeds, and every single seed can produce a tree, and every single tree can produce an orchard. It can start with one seed, and all you have to do is have enough faith in this moment. All you have to do is have enough courage in this moment. All you have to do is just trust enough in this moment. And as I leave, I need to ask you something. What are you waiting for? At this time, we're going to have a worship song by Brother D and Sister Tracy. You guys stay, and then we're going to dismiss you with a blessing. But you should be writing in your phones already. You should be putting notes to yourself already. You should be divorcing yourself from the past that had you bound. And you should be expecting that you're going to reap a great harvest. I expect something from you after planting this word your way.
Praise the Lord, church. As Pastor said, in this time, we withhold nothing. Honk your horn, we withhold nothing.
withholding nothing. I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing.
Come on, you say,
I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing.
I surrender all
to you.
Everything I give,
everything I give to you.
Withholding nothing,
withholding nothing, withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding nothing,
withholding.
Praise the Lord, church.